we just, we bask in your presence, Lord. There is no other God that's like you. What God could take a dark, void place and bring together life? And not only did he bring together life, but in the early days of creation, he thought of us. He thought of us so deep that he created this day for all of our lives to intersect. What God is so mindful that he could take so many different personalities, people from all around the world, bring them to Boston to intersect lives at 1500 Blue Hill Avenue on a Sunday morning where we could be doing anything else but God. God, thank you for leading us here. Thank you, Lord, for this worship experience where we can draw close to you. Thank you, God, for setting the stage and the atmosphere for us to receive what you have for us. You set us at your banquet table and your banner over us is love. What kind of love have you offered us? An everlasting love. A love that is wide and deep. A love that covers our sins. A love that looks beyond all of our faults and sees what we need. Oh, this kind of love is easy to surrender to. Oh, God, we thank you. We're just at your feet. We're at the hem of your garment. In your hem are all of our prayers, all of our tears. You catch every tear that we cry. You know everyone. You know everything that's on our heart. You know the things that we can't even say. You know the utterances, God. You know what we're believing you for. You know the cries of our heart. And yet, even when you search us and you see the wickedness inside of us, still love us with an everlasting love. God, we thank you. God, we can't thank you enough. If we had 10,000 tongues, it would not be enough to declare your goodness. Had it not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? The days that I wanted to give up, but God. Thank you, Lord. So God, in this atmosphere, we just bask in your presence. We let joy unspeakable rule in our hearts. Do what only you can do, Lord. Take the seed of this word and multiply it in the hearts of your people. Only you, God, could take one word and have it deciphered in 1,000 different ways. Whoever is in this room, whatever they need, God, may it be done today. So, God, we open up our hearts. I decrease so that your word may flow with fire and penetrate the hearts of your people. Because God, we know that out of the heart, the mouth speaks. So change our hearts, God. Change our hearts to be more like you. Pull away the wickedness that's in us, God. Make us go through the fire so that we may come out as pure gold. refine us, renew us. Do what only you can do, because only you can do it. In ourselves, we can't do anything, but at your feet, we can do everything. We can do all things through Christ who gives us strength. We offer this service unto you, and we say, do what you want to do. Say what you want to say. Have your way. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Hug your neighbor and say that it is good to be in the land of the living. Hallelujah. I'm so excited to share this word with you today. It's a word that, you know, whenever anyone stands before the people of God, you're giving a word that you've had to live through. And so this is a word that I'm living through. God is refining me. He's teaching me. He's growing me. And that's how you know that God is good. God is good. When you see someone growing, you know that God is in the field. It's when people are staying the same, you're wondering, what God are you serving? Because the God that I serve, every day is a new day in the kingdom of God. Every day is a day of growth. Every day is a day where new things are coming up out of the earth. New concepts are being birthed. God is a God of newness. Amen? So before I get into the word, I just want to take a moment. I haven't had a chance to thank everyone for your prayers, for your giving to the missions that you do at the end of every service. Myself and Angel and Stephanie traveled to India. Many of the women, if you were at the women's conference in May, you heard Cindy Trim give me a prophetic word and say that God has called the Dash to be international. You know, this year was the first year we changed the name of Dash to the Dash International Conference, and so to have her confirm what God was speaking was amazing. But then the next 2 weeks, I received a message from Pastor Mohan, who we've supported his ministry for over 20 years. And so to give you a backstory, just this year, Pastor Josh and Bishop were supposed to go to, was it last year or this year? Last year. They were supposed to go in March, then it got pushed back to November. In 2015-16, Pastor Matt and Pastor Zenzo were supposed to go to India to see the work that we invest in India. And so God would have it that he curated a season for me to go. And so I wasn't sure if we would be able to pull the trip off as fast as he wanted us to go, which was in September. I got the message in September, in May, and then we had to move very quickly to get visas and really get this trip together. And so the visa went through very quickly, so that was a surprise. But the fight wasn't over, because Pastor Mohan said, you may get to the port and they can decide not to let you in. So people here were praying for us, and I appreciate your prayers. We were able to get into the country, and God did a miraculous thing while we were there. I've never been so stretched in my life. When we went there, I was supposed to speak 4 times, and I ended up speaking 9 times in 6 days. By the sixth day, I was so exhausted. And I've shared this with you before. When you speak one time, it's as if you worked 8 hours. So when you see Pastor Matt going back and forth, it's as if he worked one full week on a Sunday. And so I went prepared to speak four times. So I had five messages that God had given me. So when, and I didn't have my laptop because, you know, you read all these reports on what you're supposed to do, what you're supposed to bring and take when you're traveling to different countries. So I decided to leave my laptop at home. So I had the messages on my phone. So I didn't have another four messages. And the first seven times I spoke, it was to the same group of people. A few people were added, but it was mainly the same people. So God had to work very quickly to give me messages to speak to the body of women in India. But I want to let you know that you have seed in the ground in India. Every person, that's a good place to clap. Over the last 20 years, anything that you've given to the Mission Fund and we have sent over to India, I'm telling you, to see the work that we have supported for the last 20 years is absolutely incredible. Pastor Mohan has helped build and start over 600 churches. Amen. So there are 600 churches. I visited at least 7 or 8 of them, and every time we went in, they would say, Zion Fellowship helped build this church. So I knew it wasn't, you know, sometimes you're sending money places and you don't know what's really happening there. But I'm here to tell you that things are happening in India. There was also, it was amazing to know that God called me to India as a woman. I'm not a feminist, but God is doing a move in women in today's time. I went there and God allowed me to be used as the vessel to help release over 1,200 women to use their voice in the kingdom of God and in their community. By the ninth time that I had to speak, I was literally exhausted, and I was in a room, and I was weeping because I was that tired. I felt like I did not have anything else to give. And my spiritual daughters began to pray for me. And so this particular church, the women sit on one side, the men sit on the other side. But there's no chairs. They're all sitting on their knees. And when you walk into the church, it is custom for you to take your shoes off and enter the sanctuary. And as I entered the sanctuary, the Spirit of God strengthened me to speak to hungry men and women, hungry for the Word of God. No chairs. Some of them didn't even have Bibles, but they were hungry in their amen and their hallelujah. When I tell you, it ministered to my soul and gave me the strength to do God's work. And I was able to do that because of all that you give. And I'm telling you, as you pray, you can pray and say, God, I have seed in the ground. And women in India were released because of my seed. Amen? So thank you. The message I have to share with you today comes out of pain in my life. If you missed women's ministry yesterday, you missed something. We had an amazing woman of God, Jessica, speak, and she shared her story on suffering. And I'm telling you, I haven't been able to put the last 5 years of my life in perspective, or God hasn't really given me a word of what I went through. Because, you know, when you're in something, sometimes it's very difficult to really put a word on it. You just know that you're living, you're doing, taking care of kids, DCF, worrying about my daughter, trying to get her in a place where she can be stable and God could use her. But the moment she said the word suffering, it was like I had an aha moment. And I said, God, that's what was happening with me. I was in a suffering season, but your grace, your grace is sufficient. And I know, like, some people would say to me, like, I know you're going through a lot, but it doesn't really seem like you're going through anything. And literally, it's like, because I have to keep these kids. I got to be hopeful for kids. I have to get my son through high school. I have five congregations that I oversee. Like, I don't have time to be on the ground whining. I have to do what I need to do. And God's strength was giving me the power to do what he called me to do. And so this message today comes out of a conversation that I had with my daughter. And how many of us in life, you know, sometimes you're recalling the stories of your life and you're like, shoulda, woulda, coulda. And that's what happens a lot in the kingdom. You come into the kingdom for such a time as this, and then you start reflecting on some of the things that your mama told you that you should have listened to, right? And then you're reflecting on the things that your daddy told you, or the loved ones in your family, or just your friends, your mentors, and sometimes people are giving you good wisdom, but in your mind, you have a better way. How many of us have been there? I don't see a lot of hands, but I'll put up my hands and feet, because I remember things that my mother said to me and I ignored them. I didn't want to hear it. But when I went back to her and said, I shoulda, it was like there was a glow on her face, like, I told you so. But this conversation that you're about to enter into that Tavisha and I had, I didn't feel that way. When she came to me and she started recalling some of the things that she hadn't listened to, I halted her. I said, Tavisha, no. Everything that you went through was for a reason in the kingdom of God. We're not going to go down the road of shoulda, woulda, coulda. The title of my message is Shoulda, Woulda, Coulda. But time belongs to God. And I'm going to show you today how to redeem your time, because time is precious in the kingdom of God. And I don't know if we're always looking at time as a precious commodity, but time, according to God, is one of the most precious things that he gives to us. And I'm convinced that if we use time correctly, that God can redeem the years that the locust has tried to steal from us. Amen? So here we are. There are 12 months to a year. There are 52 weeks to a year. There are 365 days to a year. There are 8,760 hours to a year. There are 525,600 minutes to a year. And there are 31,536,000 seconds to a year. Everything that we do is based on the commodity of time. We're always talking about time, even when we're not talking about time, because we live in time. We're always like, what time is it? I have to be here. My doctor's appointment is at 10 o'clock. I go to bed at 9 o'clock. I wake up at 7 o'clock. We're always talking about time, but I'm not sure if when we talk about time, we're talking about time as a precious commodity. See, stock doesn't matter. Time is given to us by God. And time is not to be wasted. But God, in his infinite wisdom, even if we waste time, once we come into the realization of what time really is, He says, I can redeem the time. That's the kind of God we serve. We serve a God who can make a day seem incredibly fast, and then we serve a God who can make a day feel incredibly slow. In my belief, I believe that when time is feeling really fast, there's someone that's praying. Maybe it's a woman who's about to get married and she's saying, I can't wait until Saturday. And then the week seems to go incredibly fast and we don't know why. But then maybe when time feels really slow, someone's on their deathbed praying that God would just give them one more day. And then that day seems incredibly slow. God, in his infinite wisdom, can make time work for every single person in this room. Isn't he an incredible God? There are four biblical time words that depict divine work in the Bible. Kairos is a time measured of time. It's a larger or smaller portion of time. It's a fixed time. It's a definitive time. It's a time when things are brought to crisis. It's an opportune or seasonable time. It's the right time. It's a limited period of time. That's a kairos time. Chronos is different. It's a time that's either long or short. And then there's a time that's called aion time, A-I-O-N. It's a time forever. It's an unbroken age. It's a perpetuous time. And then there's eternity. Eternity is endless. It's immeasurable. It's infinite. So we're always operating in those four types of times, even when we read the Word of God and as we live our time out. And God sent me here today, as I'm living through this time, to just share with you the conversation that I had with Tavisha. So Tavisha, as she was talking to me, she said, Mom, as I'm looking over the recourse of my life, I see the things that you said to me, and if I had a listened, then maybe my life would be different. And I said to her, I said, well, Tavisha, we're not going to go down that road, because that's a road the enemy wants you to go down. Because I hear from a lot of people, if I had only done this, if I didn't have that abortion, if I had just come to Christ sooner, if I had just followed direction, maybe my life wouldn't be where it is. But here's the real thing, Jubilee. Then if you lived a perfect life, what could you offer out to people in a dying world? See, when we were going through our major crisis, and I was like, God, I've done everything in your kingdom. Like, why are we going through this? This is painful. Now that I'm on the other side of it, God is showing me that I can offer out that pain as a peppermint stick to the body of Christ. I can say to the grandmother who writes me on Facebook and is, how did you make it? I can say to her, it was through God's grace that I made it. I didn't know the days if my daughter was dead or alive, but God, he got me through it, and he can get you through it. Who would speak to that person had I not gone through it? Now, I'm not saying when I was going through my pain that I was skipping and jumping and happy. I was questioning God. Why would you have me go through this pain in front of thousands of people? Why, God? You've given me a ministry to women, and yet my daughter is suffering. Why would you do this to me? And God just kept saying, wait till the appointed time. But when we're in it, the appointed time seems like an eternity. God, take this cup from me. It's too painful. And he said, just wait. A Kairos moment is about to happen. A Chronos moment is about to happen. You're one word away. You're one step away. You're one breath away from the season and time that God has for you. Turn with me to Genesis. And the thing about the word of God that's so amazing to me is that God could take a word and he could take this word that he's given me for me first and then to give out to you. He could take this word and just like the seeds that we plant into the ground, this word will be planted in every single person in the room, but it will bear different fruit. I don't know what God is speaking to you today about time, but you are going to be responsible for everything that you hear today. I love how God, in Genesis 1, I've read Genesis 1 with the mindset of creation. I've read Genesis 1 with the mindset of order. I've read Genesis 1 with the mindset of God, you're amazing. But I've never read Genesis 1 from the perspective of time. When I began to read it from the perspective of time, there were some things that I began to notice. In the beginning, I need a Bible because my phone's not working. See, this is technology. You try to have light stuff, and thank you, Pastor Josh. You're such a man of God. Carry a Bible. If Pastor Matt was here, he'd be like, that's why I have my Bible. But, you know, we're getting holy. This is why we should bring Bibles to church, not just electronic. It's still buffering. In the beginning, God created heavens and earth. And now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. Verse 3, and God said, let there be light. And there was light, and God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, and there was the first day. And God said, let there be an expanse between the waters to separate water from water. So God made the expanse and separated the water under the expanse from the water above it. And it was so. And God called the expanse sky, and there was evening, and there was day. And that was the second day. And God said, let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let dry ground appear. And it was so. And God called the dry ground land, and the gathered waters he called seas. And God said it was good. And then God said, let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants, and trees on the land that bear fruit, and trees on it with seed in it according to the various kinds. And it was so. And the land produced vegetation, plants bearing seed according to their kind, with seed in it according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, and there was the third day. And God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the sky to separate the day from night, and let them serve as signs to mark seasons and days and years, and let them be lights in the expanse of the sky to give the light. And it was so. And God made two greater lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. And he also made the stars, and God set them in the expanse of the sky to give light on earth to govern the day and night and separate the light from darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, and there was the fourth day. And then we see the fifth day and the sixth day, and we see how God rests. But I want to highlight the fourth day. God, when he created the fourth day, is really when time began, or time was being governed. Because it's the fourth day that we see the sun and the moon and the earth come on the scene. The sun, the moon, and the earth is what produces a day. A day cannot happen without the sun and the moon and the earth. Pastor Josh, can you come up and what you said to me upstairs? Because that was supposed to be part of my message, so you'll be part of my message now. So Pastor Josh, we were upstairs just sharing, you know, just about time and how amazing God is. And I didn't say to him that inserted in my message, I was going to put what he's about to say, because I think you need to hear this. Because there are always 2 days happening every day on earth. When I was in India, I would call Pastor Matt, and it would be a different day here than in India. And I would say to him, I love you more because I'm a day ahead of you. When he was in the Philippines, he would say to me, I love you more because I'm a day ahead of you. There are always 2 days that are operating. What kind of God could make a world where 2 days are operating always at the same time? That's pretty amazing. And we walk around and we don't take full advantage of time because we're walking around, we're claiming things that we shouldn't say. I'm tired. Oh, today is taking so long. Instead of saying, I'm just rejoicing that today has 24 hours in it. It's 24 hours for me to do the things that God has called me to do. 24 hours for me to advance the kingdom of God. 24 hours for me to pray more for my loved one who's lost in darkness. God is going to give us a different concept of time today. We will look at time as a commodity on the stock market. Amen? So, Pastor Josh, tell us how time evolves. The earth, yes.
So, with the creation of the earth is the beginning of Chronos time, because that's how we measure Chronos time. We know, by the way, that the sun comes up and it goes down, and the time is measured. Now, the earth spins on its own axis at 24,000 miles an hour. So it's 24,000 miles in diameter, right? And as it spins, you get 1 day. It also spins around the sun at 33,000 miles an hour. So right now, we're spinning on an axis at 24,000 miles an hour, and we're spinning around the universe at 34,000 miles an hour, and we feel like we're standing still. But the human measurement or chronos of time began with the formation of the earth, because we had to begin to track the daily pieces that we get held to. So it makes sense now, as Pastor Mona was talking, that in the formation, the spiritual formation of a earth began to allow us to track where we are at this moment, which is 11:28.
Amen. My buffering stopped. Yeah, thank you. Isn't that amazing? But this is another amazing fact, is that if any of those things stopped even for a second, we would all crash into each other and die. It cannot stop, not even 1 second. If you study science, if any of those things went off track, my gosh, I'm telling you, it's the most amazing thing to study. But God, he didn't make that until the 4th day. But he called day 1, day 1, day 2, day 2, day 3, day 3. And then he did not make time until day 4. He's the master creator. I mean, when you get this concept of time, how it will revolutionize what you do. Turn with me to Ecclesiastes. The first thing is know your time. Understand your time in Genesis. When God created time, according to Genesis. And when he created the world according to Genesis on day one, we enter into day one, but we don't know what the pre-time was. But when day one began to happen, God in his infinite wisdom knew the day that you would be born, the season, the time, the place. He set you apart for a particular reason. How old you are, how young you are, where you work, where you go to school, where you go to church is all for a specific purpose and reason. So you have to understand your time. Never think you're too old. There was a season where I was just like, okay, God, I just a couple of years ago, God, you called me to do this. When is that going to happen? And he said, I have time in my hands. I'm putting some things in order. Other people have to come into place in order for a synchronicity to happen for you to move forward. I thought that I had this idea to put international on the Dash conference. But no, God was showing me that you thought you put that there. But then I had to wait until you were ready to receive the ministry of Dr. Cindy Trim so that she would sit in a chair and keep staring at you and hear the word of God give her a message for you at the appointed time. God is getting you ready for a Rubik's Cube click that's about to happen in your life. I've had this image after the Jubilee conference. And if you weren't here, I suggest you go on live stream and watch the three messages. The three messages were basically preparing us for the season that we're about to go into Jubilee. And as my family, as my brothers and sisters, I don't want anyone to miss it. I know all of you have prayers that are in the hem of the garment of Jesus. All of us have prayers. All of us have things we're believing God for. All of us have loved ones that are sick, that are in bondage. All of us have prayers that we're believing God for. And he wants you to understand the time that you're in, the season that you're in. And God gave me a picture. He said, Mona, Jubilee is the plane is boarding. And when you board a plane, once you get on the plane, you cannot get off. If you get off the plane, they will not let you back on because of everything that has happened, 9/11. So security is really tight. We're on the plane. And God is saying, listen, you're on the plane, strap up. Because we're about to take off. What was last year? The oil of yesterday has grown stale. Where he's taking us right now is a different place. I don't know what the destination is, but I know it's elevation. Because what God does, he only goes up. Down is hell. God is a God. He says high above the heavens. So God showed me. He showed me this airplane. And he said, if the people of God could just get on, once they get on, even when the door closes, even if you sit on the tarmac for a couple of hours, I don't know about you, but I've gotten on an airplane and we've just been waiting to take off for hours. But God said, it doesn't matter. As long as you're on the plane, you will take off. And God sent me today to encourage you. Don't get weary in well-doing. Don't get weary. Stay connected to the vine because the plane is taking off. Ecclesiastes says this to us. As I've been studying this whole notion of time, I'm studying time because I felt like, God, I'm 53. You've given me a word. You've given me promises. When are they going to happen? And he began to show me there's a time for everything under the sun. If I had given it to you too early, you weren't ready for it. You weren't mature enough. You think you were mature. You think you were rooted and grounded. But now when I give it to you, you're ready. He's calling us to mature, not to be ruled by our emotions. Emotions are temporary. Don't get caught up. Did you see how they looked at me today? Nobody's looking at you anyway. You woke up on the wrong side of the bed. You're not getting enough sleep. There's room at the table for you. Stop sulking. Stop being negative. No, there's a place for you. You just got to get involved. Nobody knows your name because you come in and you leave right away. You want somebody to know your name? Stop serving in the kingdom. There's room at the cross for everybody. As I was studying Ecclesiastes from the perspective of time, what I found out is that there are 28 contrasting time principles in Ecclesiastes. The amazing thing is one of the scholars said that the number 28 is the number of the moon cycle. See, in the Hebrew calendar, what has happened, see, because when God develops time, I need you to know that everything God does is on purpose and with an order, and there is a reason. So the reason that I study the Hebrew calendar is because, can you imagine that God made every month without a purpose? Every month has a governing principle. When God decided to make the days, every day has a governing principle. Every day when you begin to study the days and you begin to live, when he says, I separated the waters above and the waters below, you will begin to start separating things in your life. Well, God, no, I don't think I'm better than this person, but if they're speaking negativity, my water needs to separate from their water because I can't have my river polluted. I've got to go after the things of God. So he created everything. It says in chapter 3, verse 1, it says, there is a season, a time appointed for everything, a time for every delight, every event, and every purpose under heaven. There's a time to be born and a time to die. See, in the middle of living and being born and dying, I believe sometimes we just read this and we're like, yeah, there's a time to be born and there's a time to die. But what are you doing with the middle? Yes, you're born and yes, you know you're going to die, but how are you living? Then it says there is a time to plant and there's a time to uproot what is planted. And God is saying, okay, these are the things that were planted in you when you were younger, but now that you've come to Christ for such a time as this, what needs to be uprooted in your life? We're not just reading this as, oh, that's cute, and oh, yeah, that's going to happen. No, we're reading it to understand what we need to do in the middle. There's a time to kill and a time to heal. There's a time to kill the things in your life that are not like God. And then there's a time to allow the Holy Spirit to heal you of the things that have happened in your past. That's how we read Ecclesiastes 3. Because Ecclesiastes 3, if it's on a 28, it's on 28 contrasting times, and it goes according to a moon cycle, it means that God is saying every month, you need to be looking at this and getting yourself right. Last month and this month, in the Hebrew calendar, last month was the month of Elul. In the month of Elul, it's a very critical time in the Hebrew calendar because it's a time of reflection. It's a time when you're looking at your previous year and you're looking and you're saying, okay, God, these are all the things that happened to me. And these are the things that I'm believing you for in my next year. But then you're also looking to see the things that broke God's heart. Now, we know as Christians, we should be repenting every day. We should be atoning every day. God, what did I do today that broke your heart? But let's be honest. How many of us, at the end of every day, before we lay our head down, we just sit and we say, what did I do wrong today, God? What do I need to repent for today, God? What was not like you today, God? I would contend that not many of us do that. So what happens is day after day after day after day after day, you're not taking care of the inner man and cleansing your soul. Most of us are waiting for like the big thing to happen. I cussed my boss out today. Because you know we have cussing Christians. And look, come on. Somebody cut you off. You got a few words to say. You're in your car, so ain't nobody hearing you, but you've given a few fingers. You've given a few head movements. How many of us actually sit and repent? I'm here to tell you, I haven't, not every single day, unless it's a big blaring sin. But I sat in this month, and I started thinking as I was reflecting over the year, and I said, God, I have failed you. I have some anger issues. Bad. I might not be saying stuff, but it's in my head, and you heard it. Pastor Matt getting on my nerves. I'd be cussing him out all in my head. And he's like, why are you moving like that? Because it's like, because what's going on in my head? You can't hear it, but I'm saying it. And God just started dealing with me. He's like, no. Then my overspending. Just because, you know, there's a guy, Clarence, I don't need to always be with Clarence. He was like, no, that's a sin. It's gluttony. Why are you? You don't need another pair of black shoes. I don't care what hue of black it is. We make excuses for our sin. Unforgiveness. You think somebody saw you and they didn't speak. She didn't even speak. Oh, I got nothing to say to her. So God started dealing with me. And I just, I wanted to be free from everything. I just started writing and writing. Next thing I knew, I had like 30 things. I was like, I'm a wretched mess. And I said, I know there's probably more, but I don't really have any more time to sit and reflect on this. This is killing me. And then the thing that I love about the season of Yom Kippur. Now, I'm mature enough to know that there, in the faith of the Jewish culture, many of them haven't moved beyond the Old Testament. But I know Jesus. And I know I'm supposed to repent daily. But I was reminded of the fact that I hadn't been doing that and cleansing my temple. So what happened was I wrote all those sins down. And then I found some water. And I had the pieces of paper. And I said, God, your word says, cast our cares upon you. And so I want to cast these negative things that are not like you. And cast in the Greek means to hurl with all your might. And I said, I want to hurl these things. Because in this next season that you're calling me to, I don't have time for these things to be part of my life. And so in Jubilee, this is what happened. I went to a body of water. And for the environmentalists out there, I'm so sorry. I don't know. I was very careful because I don't know if this is legal, so I'm not suggesting you do it unless you have biodegradable paper. I wasn't really concerned about that. I just needed my spirit cleansed. And so I couldn't really hurl because I didn't want to get arrested. But in my mind, I was hurling, and I took those 30 things and I placed them in the water. And I said, God, I want to be free. I want to be free. But here's the amazing thing. I placed them as a clump, but immediately a bunch of them just started flowing away really quickly. And I was like, as I was standing there, I noticed that three, they were just having trouble moving along. I wanted to pull them out so I could see, like, these must be the three things that are hard for me to overcome. But as I was watching, and I was, go. All the other things are floating. They're gone. These things. It just, do. And as I was standing there, the Holy Spirit spoke to me. And I knew one of them was anger. Because I used to be, because I cast it into the sea. And it's not always anger like temple anger like Jesus, like in the temple, because you can be angry and sin not. But my anger, thank God I don't own a firearm or a knife, because my anger, God said, I got to get that out of you for what I'm calling you to. And don't you know, as I cast all of those things into the ocean, I'm calling it an ocean. It wasn't an ocean. As I cast it into the little pond, the very next day I was tested. And you know what I was able to say? I cast that into the sea. That's gone. That season is over. Now, maybe some new things I got to cast in tomorrow, but those things, they're gone. So there is a time, Genesis, there's a season, Ecclesiastic, for everything under the sun. But here's the part that I'm so excited to share with you, Jubilee, is that your time and your season are connected to your obedience. I'm going to play a short clip. And this is the part that I was able to share with my daughter. I said, Tavisha, I said, God will restore the time that the locust has eaten. He's going to restore that time for you. And don't you know, just this week, well, I'll take you to Sunday. This past Sunday, New Life came to visit, and at the end of the conference, they came to hear the word of God. Tavisha was the driver and the leader of the new women that are now in the program. That's how God restores time. Not only that, they've encouraged her to apply for a position in the program. The amazing thing is that they know any woman that has come through the program has a past, but they still need to run a background check. And so she was nervous. She said, I know they already know I have a background, and she shared her testimony. So she's totally fine. She is delivered, set free. She's like, Mom, whatever part of my testimony you want to share, you can share it, because God has set me free. She had been arrested 4 times that we know of. So she said, Mom, they already know, but I'm still a little nervous. When the background check came, there was nothing on her record. God redeems time. I want you to see this clip because Joel 1 says this. It says, what the gnawing locust has left, the swarming locust will eat. What the swarming locust has left, the creeping locust will eat. What the creeping locust has left, the stripping locust has eaten. See, it's not just one locust. I mean, the locusts are coming to destroy, to annihilate you, to kill you, to strip you of everything. Awake from your intoxication, you drunkards. Weep, wail, all you drinkers of wine, because of the fresh, sweet wine that is cut from your mouth. Locusts, they eat plants. They hop along long distances. They can lie dormant in the ground for 20 years. And as soon as a swarm comes, they will come up out of the ground. They start out crawling and they immediately go to jumping. And from jumping, they go to flying. And this all happens very quickly. The problem is locusts gather in big groups or swarms. And as the swarm descends, the insects eat everything in sight. Garden crops, flowers, grass, and even clothes hanging on a line. The beautiful thing that I'm here to tell you is that when destruction happens, when God restores, it's never the same. It's always better. Have you ever seen a house catch on fire? When they build the new house is better. I'm here to tell you that when you cast your cares upon Him, when you believe what the Word of God says, when you call out and cry out to God in this season of the mouth, when you decree and you declare the things that have been scattered and you call them back to wholeness, when God restores, it will never be like what the enemy destroyed in your life. Shoulda, woulda, coulda, but time belongs to God. We're gonna watch this short clip because I want you to get a picture of what the enemy does in your life.
There is no other species on the planet that responds as quickly and as dramatically to the good times as the desert locust. Eggs that have remained in the ground for 20 years begin to hatch. The young locusts are known as hoppers, for at this stage they're flightless. They find new feeding grounds by following the smell of sprouting grass. Normally, it takes 4 weeks for hoppers to become adults, but when the conditions are right, as now, their development switches to the fast track. As the vegetation in one place begins to run out, the winged adults release pheromones, scent messages, which tell others in the group that they must move on. And when groups merge, they form a swarm.
We can stop it. It is said that when a swarm begins to form, it can be as long as 400 miles. That's what the enemy tries to do in your life. He's not coming playing patty cake. He's coming to destroy you. But God can send one angel And one angel can cut down a swarm in 1 second. Because that's the kind of God that we serve. So I said to Tavisha, I said, well, that's Joel 1, but let's look at Joel 2. Joel 2:25 says this, I will restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten, the crawling locust, the consuming locust, the chewing locust, my great army which I sent among you. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied. And praise the name of the Lord your God who has dealt wondrously with you. Sometimes we skip over words, but this word is saying who has dealt with you. And dealing with you, that means that he's excavating the things that are not like him so that he can deal wondrously with you. When he deals wondrously with you, it says, my people shall never be put to shame. You will never be put to shame. All that has been taken in this season right now, in the season of the mouth, in the season in which you can decree and declare the good things that God has for you, in this season when you will chew on the word of God and you will meditate day and night so that out of your heart, out of your mouth, your heart will speak. If your heart is wicked and deceitful, it cannot speak good things. But when you meditate on the law day and night, you can speak the things of God because that's all that shall come out of your mouth. It says, and then you shall know that I am in the midst of Israel. I am the Lord your God, and there is no other God like me. And my people, again, shall never be put to shame. So God sent me to tell you that when you're obedient, you shall eat the fruit of the land. He knows that we're going to sin. He's not looking for a perfect people, but he's looking for a people that are going to repent, that are going to recognize where they fall short, because he already knows you're going to fall short again and again, but he just wants to know that you recognize it. What good parent is going to allow their kids to continue to do the same negative things over and over that will impede upon the blessing of their future? God says, I've made you the head and not the tail, above only and not beneath. I want what's best for you. I want you to live your days out, not in perfection, but in knowing that he is the God and he is Lord Almighty. This is what I want to leave you with. Psalm 90, verse 4 says this, do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. That's time redemption. If you had one day left on this earth, it could feel like 1,000 days. God says, he holds time in his hands. How dare you think you're too old? How dare you think you're too young? God called you to live in the season that you're in, even if you're in this room and the doctors have said you only have a week to live. 7 days is like 7,000 days in the kingdom of God. Stand to your feet. God, we just thank you and we praise you. We thank you for the time, the season, the obedience, and God, most importantly, the peace that surpasses all understanding that we can get this time factor right. I decree and declare over the people of God in this service, the people of God that are listening on live stream, that are listening on Facebook Live. I decree that time will never be the same for you. I decree that even today, that you would offer time back to God as a sacrifice. That every word that would proceed from your mouth, that it would be seed that is going into the ground and that it would produce a harvest. And that even when the enemy tries to come in and steal your seed, that you would say, my God, you said that you would redeem what the locust has tried to steal from me. God, I pray right now that you would open the mouths of those that can't even speak. I thank you, God, that one day in your court is like a thousand elsewhere. I thank you for the redemption of time. I thank you that dreams that have been buried, God, that they're resurrecting. And that time is being redeemed even for those. God, I thank you that your people would not get weary in well-doing, but that they would reap the harvest that you set since the beginning of time. You are God, and you hold everything in your hand. You hold our lives, our destiny, our purpose. There's a time to be born, and there's a time to die, but there is a time to live that is in between. God, we thank you that you're giving us revelation in accordance to your word about time. May we never be the same. May we live according to the time that you declared on day 4 in the heavens. God, we give ourselves over to you. And we say whatever time we have left on this earth, let us use it wisely so that we can advance the kingdom of God. The plane is taking off, and we want to be a part of everything that you're doing. We want to be a part of the global movement that you're setting forth. God, we are no longer the same. Mediocrity cannot exist because you are not a mediocrity God. You are excellent in everything that you do. And so, God, we walk in accordance to your time. And we say, have your way in this place. Have your way in this season. Fuel the next decade of our lives so that we can walk in jubilee, not just for ourselves, but for you and for every person that would come into the pathway that you set forth for us. And we would be careful to give your name all the praise, honor, and glory that is due to you. Thank you. And we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.